Tim. Thank you very much for checking in again. Following the success of the RDLC's lockdown interviews, we were minded to do this again. But what we wanted to do is continue with our Zoom sessions with really inspiring, interesting people who can add value to the recruitment business leader marketplace. This new series is all about M&A and maximizing shareholder value, something that every recruitment business leader does. Typically, the first thing you do is give your business a name, and the second thing you do is think of your exit strategy. More people think about that route than you think. So without further ado, today's guest, he's a friend of the RDLC. He's a friend of mine. He's done quite a lot of work on behalf of M&A with our community. And I think you'll find him really interesting. He's also got a brand new business that he's desperate to talk about today. So when you see his background is in sunny Spain, this is the reason why he came off the beach. Paul, wow, your profile. I'm going to read it out and then I'll introduce you. So Paul is the CEO of Blue Box Corporate Finance. Blue Box's key offerings is preparing business in advance of a sale, selling businesses and raising money. Paul is recognised as an authority, if not the authority, in the sale of private companies and a significant amount of hands-on experience in selling private businesses, ranging from $2 to $200 million. Your list of sales is brilliant, by the way. The higher profile businesses that Paul has sold include GE, Mapping and Web, Model Zone, Smythsons, Watches of Switzerland, Princess Yachts, that must have been brilliant, ETAM, World Trade Group, this is the funniest one, this would never fit in a pen, is it? British Retail, Consortium Global Standards, and I don't even know what the Neil's patient is. In 2020, Paul set up a brand new business, but I'll let you explain that yourself. So without further ado, hi, Paul.
Hey, Gary, how are you doing?
All right.
Greetings from warm Spain, where quarantine's very much top of the agenda. Everyone's talking about out here.
Yeah, no, they're part of me fucking anxious for being there. only I could get out there, buddy. Paul, first things first, how have you been during lockdown? What have you been up to? And how on earth did you get to Spain ahead of all this drama? Lucky boy.
Do you know, it's probably politically incorrect to say it, but it's not been too awful. I mean, I obviously the humanitarian disaster that is COVID has been concerning and something we've been looking at for a long while. And I'm not going to say we called it quite early, but I remember saying to some people in our office in January, this could happen, and everyone thinking I was absolutely bonkers. And I thought I was bonkers as well. And it's mind blowing to see what's happened. But the very sad thing is, notwithstanding the humanitarian impact, I think the economic tsunami that is starting and will continue is going to be devastating. So what have I been doing? Well, yeah, I was fortunate. We did manage to get out to Spain a couple of weeks back. And just spending some enjoyable family time, but still doing quite a bit of work out here. But I suppose M&A, and there's not many in the market saying it, but I'll say it as it is, M&A is not booming at the moment. There's elements of M&A that are booming and some sets are booming, but ordinarily you'd have to think, you know, if you're thinking with your gut, that now is not the time to start running out and selling a business. I mean, there will be inevitably people who are very sadly forced into a position of an exit. And there will be, I suspect, an even larger number that have been through this and have reprioritized in life and thinking about what they're doing. But the good old world of M&A, I think, is at the moment going to be relatively quiet. I mean, don't get me wrong, I still see a flow of deals regularly. I see deals every day, and we're still involved in a number of pretty big deals, including a couple of high-profile ones, which, sadly, I can't talk about yet. But I think priorities will be changing. The market will be shaping up differently. As ever in these markets, what happens is the bigger advisors come down into the pond where mere mortals like us start fishing. I think that there will be a disruption, and it'll be one of those. It's a very cyclical market, and you'll know, as one of the doyens in the recruitment market, Gary, you'll know as well as I do that certain sectors are very cyclical. And I'd argue in some ways that recruitment and M&A follow similar pathways, you know, the first to get hit and let's all hope the first to come back. And that's where it is. And I think just generally across the economy now, there are businesses that are going to be absolutely devastated, and it's going to unravel, and we'll see that in the coming weeks and months. But you know, as long as you've got the resources to see yourselves through, I think it's become, and I don't obviously have a conflict suggesting this, but I think there is an argument that in this market, finding a safe harbour, maybe with a strategic partner that can assist you in growing and support the business with deeper pockets, is no bad thing. So personally, not too traumatic a lockdown, and I believe we're very privileged in that regard. But economically, I think there's a lot worse to come, and the market will change, and people are going to need to change the way they operate. I mean, look at the way that we're operating now. Normally, we'll be getting together for a glass of wine and one of your fabulous RDLC lunches, and those now are unfortunately off the agenda for a while, unless I just haven't been invited.
And we have. Yeah, you weren't invited. But you couldn't get there anyway. But brilliant insight. Do you think there's appetite for people to acquire distressed businesses, or are the people who've got the cash really targeting people, you know, who could add some value? But what would a good target look like today, potentially? Or is there appetite for both?
So I think that as ever, there are different acquirers in the market, and you mentioned some of the deals that I've done, and I won't mention the specifics. I don't want to get myself into hot water, but there are buyers out there that clearly are bottom fishers, and they're waiting for an opportunity. They're waiting to pounce on deals that are in trouble, and it's not about a strategic value. It's about capitalising on a situation and frankly taking advantage of someone else's weakness. However, I absolutely believe that this is also a time where those that are best placed to create value, notwithstanding the impact that COVID will inevitably have had on businesses across the market, they will be looking for different angles. And you know, without being too crude, if you look at someone who's at the moment in the recruitment and they're involved in meeting software, and it's a very different space to other generalists. And there may be things that people are thinking about strategically where they want to move. The one big dynamic we have seen, Gary, is private equity has continued to roll. When I say that, the funds that are out there are still investing money. It's Turkey's voting for Christmas if they start handing money back to investors. And they're sat there saying, we're still here and we're still out and we're still buying. And that's providing some liquidity and some activity in the market for sure. But the other thing that's been surprising is there are strategics out there that are buying and that are looking at the right position, at the well-positioned assets in the context of what the new world will bring. I'd be happy with any of your members. I'd more than happy to support any of your members. And it's about looking at the specifics of a business. But in some ways, you can't necessarily put lipstick on a pig, as they say. And some businesses that have been hit badly will be at this point in time unsaleable, apart from to those bottom fishers, and others will be very, very well strategically placed. It is a good time to go and acquire if you can find a strategic asset that fits well within your portfolio. And obviously you've got a realistic vendor expectation. So the market, I have to say, and I'm a glass half empty person, but the market has certainly held up better than I would have predicted back in the beginning of March.
It's really interesting because a lot of recruitment businesses have more cash in the bank now than they've ever had. So that they've had staff wages being paid for, they're doing more business with fewer, that the government have given them free money, as Marion Somerset Webb said, take every penny that you can, and hope, fingers crossed, for some financial jubilees. Yeah. We both know who you're talking about when we talk about bottom feeders. Voldemort, his name should never be mentioned, and we won't mention it. There's a really interesting shift in dynamic going on within our
sector. I'm not sure you've got the right person, Gary, but we'll carry on.
Yeah, we do. there's a really interesting shift in dynamic that's going on in recruitment. The recruitment is dead, as a word, and everyone's shifting to become consultancy-driven, getting paid for effort, not just returns, outsourced in-house statement of works. And everyone is just running into that solution-based selling, at least a million miles an hour. Do you think that might change the dynamic of who might be interested in businesses? So if people can shift pretty quickly, they've got a decent cash position, they start to trade in that marketplace, can we turn an ugly pig into a beautiful business? Or a frog or a prince?
I mean, obviously, there'll be exceptions, but interestingly, and this is not a soapbox for us to talk about our new business philosophy, but actually, if you look at most businesses with the right level of strategic thinking and insight and experience in the market, I absolutely think that can be done. Going back to using old metrics and the old KPIs and the margins and the way that you recruit and the way that you engage with clients and the various models that exist out there, I personally believe that people will need to be creative. There will be clients who are clearly looking for very much value for money from a recruiter. And there will be models. It's one of those things. I mean, it drives me absolutely bonkers every time we go out and recruit people, the fees that we pay to your lot. But it's a necessary service and there's no way around it. And people will need that. I think the supply side in many businesses is changing dramatically. And when I say that, I'm saying, if you take M&A, I've just described how I described at the outset, how the clients are changing and how the volumes in our market are falling, and maybe we'll come on to what people are looking for differently. But the other thing people need to realize is that the supply side of our business, which is frankly people and very good people, is going to change. The way that we engage with them, the way we find them, and the way that works. So I believe that now is a great time with people with energy and vision, if they can create and set about a new model that doesn't simply follow, oh, do you know what, we're going to look at a contract margin, and we were 16%, we're post-COVID now, we'll be at 14%. It's the wrong way to be thinking. This is going to be entirely new models, entirely new ways of engagement, a way to differentiate yourself in the market, the way to create a barrier to entry. So you can, I think, do that. And it's interesting you say with the cash that these people have, it's a great place to be. And if they're well-funded and they've got some great ideas, then absolutely I think they're going to be well-placed to grow, because recruitment as a service is something, because we all know, and all of, you know, many of your friends and colleagues know, is an absolute requirement in the business world.
Yeah, I love the fact you say that. We are so on the same page. Can I just take you back a step before we talk about velocity and all the great stuff? That is really, really, really exciting. I got goosebumps. Sectors that are in demand, size of business, business splits and locations. So a lot of the businesses are pivoting. I do hate that word, but everyone's using it. So they've gone from, UK is the best recruitment space on the planet, but don't touch the UK market. If they use all the talent and equipment and tools and ability and management and the resources that we've got here, but focus externally. Is that in demand? Because that's where everyone's going. Do you still get more for a contract business than a perm business? I'm going to speak to Marcus later. Right, and he was just saying equal split. It doesn't really matter where the revenue comes from. It's just generating revenue. Is there a size of business? I know previously you talked about nothing really happened to £1 million if you're a proper event. And then, is it still tech first? But just as a basic rule of thumb for someone who's desperately trying to maximise shareholder value, what things can they do in terms of the direction? Because everyone's got an opportunity now to change, as you exactly said, and that's right up my strata. It's exactly where I think.
So I think the old adage that visibility of income and the ability to see what's happening in the future has always driven value. I can point to many businesses where you've got £5 million of EBIT. Which are far less valuable than others with £1 million of EBIT. And that comes around to, and I hate to use a slightly technical word, but it's the quality of the income. It's where it comes from and what it looks like. And I think even more so in this market, people will be looking to ensure, I mean, if you've got a big contract base and you've got a whole bunch of people in banks, people will be looking at what the plans are of those customers and with regards to that base. I think it's fair to say, first of all, I'll put cards on the table. We haven't gone into the market with anything that's either perm or temp since lockdown. However, I would be very surprised if the contract model or something with didn't still achieve a significant premium on anything in the perm space, for the reason that I've just described with regards to quality of income. You can place someone, where's the longevity of that business? Where's that income? There's some forecastability. Size-wise, I think that the same would apply if we're looking across the market at the moment, maybe to some slightly larger deals, as in are people at the moment, and if you look at the buyers of the smaller businesses, the million to 2 million EBIT businesses, which are still lovely sized businesses to have, but they tend to not be acquired by the large corporates. And so I think if you look at what private equity is looking for, who are the big buyers in this market, and not just straight private equity, but private equity platforms that have made some deals and want to build up on those synergies, buy and build type plays, I think they'll come for. So naturally, I think the market will be larger in size. Something that's more fragile with a lower number than you suggested, 500,000, 600,000, 700,000, 800,000 of EBIT, I think is going to become more susceptible in the market because people become more concerned that it's closer towards break even. So that's size. Sector-wise, clearly, as ever, and as I've always said, niches pay. And if you are in the niche at the moment and you're placing serviced office staff, you probably are not going to be celebrating or that attractive to a market. However, if you are someone who provides technology services to remote workers and to other markets, or I won't use all the COVID case studies, but you know what I'm talking about, your masks and your technology. And I mean, if you're someone who supplies staffing into medical testing facilities, of which there are a number, yes, you'll probably be very, very well placed. So sector-wise, I think people will have refocused on the sectors that are appropriate to look at. Size-wise, I think there will be a trend toward deals. Feature of buyers, private equity features looms large. And what the private equity guys are doing is they're coming in this market with less leverage, because the banks, and one would argue sensibly, are not giving it to them. So they've got to go in less levered. But they realise that unless they do that, they're not going to be competitive in an M&A process and they're going to lose their deals. But private equity is a big piece. And the other thing that people will be looking for is they'll be looking for low cost bases. And I think that's really across the board, whether it be for staffing, whether it be for premises, other infrastructure. People won't want to be looking at businesses with huge cost. To have your swanky office in wherever you are across the UK or in London, those longer term commitments, I think buyers and what we're seeing on other deals are more jittery with regards to what could happen if we had another lockdown, if there's another event. Because of course, what you need to realise, and I'm sure you do, is pre-lockdown, people are concerned about what happens if such and such, we suffer a decline in 5% here or 10%, or disaster, it's 20. People didn't actually contemplate that there could be a shutdown in what's going on in business. And that's what's happened. So a flexibility, a low level of operational gearing, a low level of fixed cost in the business, and a business model that allows you to scale without the requirement to get lots of people on board is going to be a feature of what people are going to be looking for. So for all of your members who are looking to do the right thing and build those new businesses, and I think it's a great time to be doing that. For all of those that are doing that, it's about having flexibility and cost base. And if someone said, I'm going to get 50 people on board and we can deliver this and we'll employ all of them, wrong model. Is there a way to do it on a contract base? I'm talking about for your specific staff. So there'll be some trends, and I think it will become more apparent as we move forward.
We are so on the same page here. Can I just quickly touch upon MBOs for a second? So I reckon there might be, all of the CEOs who work with the IDLC, we haven't taken a day off. We've absolutely grafted all the way through this. And I think people don't really realise the stresses and strains that come with that. So we're worried about ourselves, our families, our businesses, finance, and then other people and their families, right? It's been a really tough time. I wouldn't be surprised right now that a lot of people just say, this is enough, I've had enough, and then want to sell this to their existing staff. Is there availability for funds for that? Is is there an appetite for it? Would you say that's still an attractive proposition for like you to facilitate it? Or it's, you know, just...
Well, let me put myself at loggerheads with a number of people in the advisory community, and I say this, and I don't know who will pick up on this video, but I've always been of the view that there's an overly close relationship between those in private equity and those in the corporate advisory market. Because what happens is someone comes in to sell a business, and the advisor knows that the quick and easy way to do it is to stick them with one of their mates, whoever it may be, and I won't name names in the private equity community, but you know the guys, and there's plenty of them, to do a deal. And what they do is they say, "Oh yeah, come on board. Don't worry, we'll find you a fund. Excuse me, a funder for your MBO, it'll be easy." And of course, what happens is they're enticed to sign up and to engage, and then once they start going through the process, they realise there's no real value from this MBO for them. They could have got more money in other ways, and frankly, by borrowing through the business in many cases. And they've only been encouraged to go into it because of this advisory relationship where the advisor's putting them with their mates in private equity. Do I think at the moment, and of course there will be exceptions, do I think that the MBO market is going to be awash with deals in private equity where they're coming in saying, yeah, we'll do these private... I don't think so, for the reasons that I've described above. I think new models will emerge and things will change and morph, and they certainly won't want to be taking too many risks, I don't think, in the market. However, and it's a big however, if you look at the number of platform deals that private equity has done, so they've bought a business and they're going to use that business to acquire others, which has, in my view, an advantage for the exiting entrepreneur insofar as they don't need to continue working with the business. Do I think those will continue to be a feature of the landscape? Absolutely. So standalone MBOs, can I sell mine to private equity and have to throw half my money back in? But don't worry, I'll have a 25-year-old I've got to report to for the next 5 years. I think they'll be less and less common, certainly in this market. But what we will see is the bigger players in recruitment that are private equity backed going out and acquiring, either coming back to what we said earlier, the strategic assets that they need to get into, or those that have been brought to their knees by what's gone on, and they can take advantage of a difficult situation at the moment.
I love the fact that you're alleged. Two more questions. Back to the beach. I know you're a busy man. You worked on that tan. You're looking very, very healthy and rosy, by the way. actually, we'll wrap into one question. How long before someone is thinking of an exit or an event to engage with you or like yourself? And please tell me about Velocity. I'll tell the world about Velocity because it's very exciting.
So, look, the first question, and I always said it's got a conflict of saying this. So our traditional blue box business, which is very much a hands-on corporate finance offering, you know, we charge somewhere between 30 and 40K to get started. Depending on the business, we do a lot of hand-holding. We ensure that businesses are properly prepared. They've got all of their IP in the right place. You've got a business model that properly reflects the growth. You've created the barriers to entry. You can. Your timing's right. Your management's incentivized. The honest answer to that is you need to get someone on board as early as possible. And of course, you know, my mates all turn around and go, yes, it's to get the punters in. But the reality is you can't start too early with that planning. And I think you said it earlier, Gary, with your experience, yes, the first thing after you thought about the brand is how do you get the exit? Well, I can show you plenty of recruitment businesses that have set up, or many businesses for that matter, in a particular market. And you say, it's a shame you've done that. If you would have started in a different way, you'd be in a very different place and far more attractive now. So the rather generic response to that is, as early as possible. And we engage with people normally a couple of years, somewhere between 6 months and 2 years before their exit, and assist them with that planning.
Cool. Can I just add to that? Sean Wadsworth, the day he set up his business, so probably the best event that an individual's had in recruitment in recent times, that he had his exit plan before he started. He knew exactly the journey was going on. Before he even started the business, he had a literally like a scrapbook. And he looked at every deal that had happened, who did the deal. He phoned up the individuals responsible to say, are the numbers that were published right? Because they never are. And he really went to work on this before day one. So I think you're exactly right. If you've got a plan it's 2020.
Will you know, look, if you wouldn't go and set up a coal mining business in natural resources at the moment and say, you know, I'm going to go and raise 20 million quid of fuck, people say, hang on, how are you going to flog a coal mining business? I mean, at the same time, if you said, you know, I'm going to set up something that's a whizzy business in video communications and it does X, Y, Z, and there's an angle in, and obviously you can create some form of barrier to entry and you can get around your teams. And so you know pretty early on. And the problem is that when we engage with people early, I mean, we sometimes start with, in fact, we started working with some people very, very early. And I've been involved with businesses very early, and you can do a huge amount. I mean, I had a business that we were working with a client in the pharmacy space, and we identified a model, pulled it out, and there's over 10 million quid that's been made into that business in the last, you know, 2 years. And it's the most incredible business model. In fact, Amazon have just bought our biggest competitor over in the States. And sharing that business from the beginning, you've got a formative role in the way it's being designed and guided in the context of an exit. So the answer is as early as possible. There's only so many things you can do once a business is mature. And you can turn around and say, well, why don't you focus more in here? You say, well, it's not as easy as that. And that's what a lot of advisors miss. You can't just suddenly turn a business and apologies for the use of the word again, but re-pivot in that market. So I think as early as possible on that. And just quickly on and thank you for the opportunity on Velocity. So in lockdown, I sarcastically say the M&A world is going to be absolutely thriving. And I suspect that's not the case. There'll be more competition. And don't get me wrong, we're well-funded and we're continuing to go, and we've got some fabulous clients we're still working with, and Blue Box Corporate Finance will continue, we hope, to do well. But what people really wanted in our market, and what we saw and what was driven by COVID, is people want more of a DIY solution, a quicker solution and an earlier entry point. And I think I said before, you know, it's 35, 40 grand to get going with a corporate advisor. Is there a way to do something for a dip of the toe in the water? And what we've created through Velocity and the website, if I'm allowed to say it, is blueboxvelocity.com. What we've enabled to happen is people can go in, they buy the product online, and we offer three services. I want to buy a business, I want to sell a business, and I want to raise funds. And for each of those, you have a classic and a premium package. And what you can do is you buy online. Someone said to me the other day, where do you send an invoice? I said, you don't. It's PayPal or credit card, which I loved saying. They bought it online, and within about an hour and a half, they had completed a document we'd sent them. It's all very much, I'm very OCD-ish, sadly, and it's very much a process. They got some sheets, some checklists back, brought them back to Velocity to us. We were sent them in, and within 24 hours, we had a list of investors for them and a target prospectus that they were going to use for this exercise. And that was all put together with technology behind the scenes. They'd paid 1,500 quid. We'd extended a 20% discount, which, by the way, Gary, I'd be delighted to do to your members as well. And what they then did was they approved the list. They thought it was a great list. They approved the document, which had been done automatically. And it's not a big shiny IM, you can imagine, but it's a five-page good document. And once they'd approved everything, we spoke to the investors and said, we have a client that's doing X, Y, Z. Would you be interested in talking? And of the 40, 17 people came back. It was a brilliantly researched list, got a huge amount of plaudits for the quality of the list. And they came back and said, who do we speak to? And we said, well, you speak directly to our client. We're out of the picture now. And so our client wasn't tying up with 30, 40,000 quid. They dipped their toe in the water for 1,500 quid. And they then knew, once they were contacted, that they had a dialogue. And they were able to go and speak with their mates to negotiate these deals. They could do it on their own. They could phone up the likes of Gary, who I know is very experienced in this market. They could speak to their accountant, their lawyer. If they wanted us, we still offer monthly support. It's very much non-handholding, but it's a quick, cheap, and very effective entry point for people that are looking to either buy, sell, or raise funds. It's going to be hugely disruptive in the market, we believe, because everyone out there in our market, including with Blue Box, is looking for those big monthly retainers, and that's what clients hate. So we've used the time to do that, and I'd love the feedback and from any of your guys, and we've got a team now that's more than happy to engage and talk through that, and we think it's very relevant to the market now.
I think that's absolute genius. Your price point on that is going to rip the head off this marketplace. It's very, very clever, fella.
It comes back, actually, Gary, to what we were discussing earlier, which is, it's not a case of reducing, don't worry, we'll reduce the retainer from 40 grand, we'll have to reduce it to 25 now. The market is different. People have got different motivations. They want speed. They don't want to be engaging with an advisor and 4 months later, by the time the document's ready, speaking with people, they want to do it immediately. And that's what I think this will offer, and we'll see where it goes.
I say, Paul, yet again, brilliant as ever, still smiling, still happy. Hopefully you won't have to quarantine when you do come back.
We'll see.
Enjoy your family time. Thank you very much for giving that time to me and to mine. We're going to publish that globally. So I think a lot of people will be asking for a discount. Just RDLC.
Yeah, it will just be RDLC. Don't you worry about that.
Look, the minute you're back, I'll buy you a lovely bottle of wine and Rioja and we'll celebrate properly.
Why don't we save it for a face-to-face beer when we get home?
So thank you very much. Have a lovely rest of a break. Enjoy your summer and I'll see you as soon as I can.
Thanks very much, Gary. Nice to see you. Thank you.